Hello everyone, Chris here from Spoon Graphics, back with another video tutorial. I received a couple of emails recently from people who found one of my old tutorials on how to create a letterpress effect useful, so I thought I'd use that topic for this week's video tutorial to update the technique. What we're aiming for is to recreate the cool vintage style stamped effect you often see on logos and typographic elements, which is based on the old printing techniques like letterpress or simple rubber stamps. The texture in from a lack of ink or the excessive ink bleed was once seen as a flaw in the printing process, but now the super trendy characteristics that designers love to recreate to distress and age their digital designs. So today I'll show you some techniques to produce ink stamp or letterpress style techniques in both Photoshop and Illustrator. Both apps have their pros and cons. Photoshop's much more powerful when it comes to working with textures, but the results will always be in raster format, whereas in Illustrator we can have our work in 100% vector, but the effect isn't quite as good. So let's start with the Photoshop technique. Open up your logo or typographic illustration and apply a layer mask so we can non-destructively erase away portions of the design. There's two techniques you can use, textures or brushes, so let's take a look at the textures option first. Copy a cool texture from the web, like this spray paint image from Texture Fabric, then alt-click the layer mask thumbnail in the layers panel to modify its contents. Paste in the texture, then go to Edit, Adjustments and Levels, move the sliders inwards to boost the contrast. Click on an empty area of the canvas to exit out of mask mode. Masks work by erasing the black areas of the mask from the design, so you might have to press Command and I to invert the mask contents to get a better result. Alternatively, you can always use Photoshop brushes to manually apply the texturing. Download and install a set of subtle noise brushes. Now, I'm afraid I can't remember where these specific brushes that I'm using are from. The brush names don't offer any clues, but you can find a few good freebies on the web. Dab with the brush in the layer mask to apply an even texture all over the logo. Now, real ink stamps never have a clean and crisp edge like our digital design. The ink bleeds and distorts the outline. We can replicate this in Photoshop with the ripple filter. Go to Filter, Distort and then select Ripple and change the size to large, then adjust the percentage to apply a subtle outline distortion. 20-25% should do it. The effect is looking good, but there's one more extra step that helps achieve that realistic stamped look. Adding a black inner glow will fade out the texturing around the edges, but since we've already got a layer mask applied, we need to add this effect on a new layer, otherwise the mask would erase away the glow effect and it just wouldn't work. Duplicate the logo layer, then delete the layer mask. Move the fill slider to 0%, then double click the layer to edit the layer styles. Add an inner glow effect, then change the settings to normal, black, 100% opacity, 0 choke, then alter the size to generate a subtle outline. So that wraps up the letterpress effect in Photoshop, so let's move on to Illustrator and see how a similar effect can be created in vector format. So there's two ways to add texture in Adobe Illustrator, using layer masks or permanently with the Pathfinder. Let's cover the mask technique first, which is essentially the same process as Photoshop, but with different menu names. Open the transparency panel and click the Make Mask button. Click on the thumbnail on the right to enter into mask mode, which is where you can paste in your textures. Now, you could use the same image-based textures that you would in Photoshop, but that defeats the purpose of using Illustrator because the texturing effect will be entirely raster pixel-based. To reap the full benefit of Illustrator's vector nature, use a vector texture like my free Dust and Scratches textures pack. Paste a texture into the mask and rotate and scale it to cover the artwork. You can build up as many layers of texturing as you want to achieve the best result. Just make sure the textures are all filled with black so that they erase the artwork. Click the thumbnail on the left to exit out of mask mode to see the full effect. We can also apply the equivalent of the ripple filter to achieve that ink bleed look. In Illustrator it's called the roughen effect, but it's easier to scale up the artwork first because it requires such fine adjustments. Go to Effect, Distort and Transform, then Roughen. Check the Absolute and Smooth options, then adjust the size to something really small like 0.2mm. Alter the detail amount to around a third of the way up the scale to maintain a recognisable outline of your logo design. Once you're happy with the result, scale your logo back down in size. Because we're dealing with vectors, this scaling up and down doesn't affect the quality whatsoever. Now, if you want to permanently apply a texturing effect, instead of adding the texture to a mask, you could punch out the shapes with the pathfinder. Make sure both your texture and your logo are two separate compound paths, otherwise the pathfinder can get easily upset and throw up an error. Use the shortcut Command and 8 or go to Object, Compound Path and Make while all the elements are selected. Place the texture over the logo, then hit the minus front option from the Pathfinder panel. Sit back while your computer's CPU is overloaded with thousands of vector calculations. The Photoshop version of this technique looks much better, but at least this Illustrator method is 100% vector, so you don't have to worry about scaling issues. But there's one more technique I want to show you that actually works in both Photoshop and Illustrator. This one makes use of built-in filters and effects rather than external texture files, and it generates a really cool generic stamp effect. So in a new Photoshop document, make your logo a smart object so it can be edited later. Then apply the ripple effect as described earlier in this video. Go to Image Adjustments and then Levels, then alter the output levels to give the logo a grey fill. Next, add a stroke layer style using the settings 13 pixels, normal, inside, and black as the stroke color. Under Filter, Pixelate, select Mezzo Tint, and then change the drop-down menu to Grainy Dots. Next, go to Filter and Filter Gallery, and under the Sketch heading, select Stamp, then adjust the settings to 1 for the light and dark balance, and 4 for smoothness. The result is a stylized stamp effect without the tiny details of a real texture, which actually works much better for logos when they're displayed at small sizes. Adobe Illustrator actually has these same filters built in. Unfortunately, they don't produce the effect in vector format, so when creating a document, make sure the raster effects option under the advanced menu is set to 300 ppi. First apply the roughen effect that I explained earlier, then give your logo a grey fill. Go to Effect, Stylize and Inner Glow, then set the color to black, the mode to normal, the opacity to 100%, then the blur to around 2mm. Under the Effect menu, you can find the same Photoshop filters at the bottom. Select Mezzo Tint from under the Pixelate heading and select Grainy Dots. Head back to Filter, Sketch and Stamp and enter the same settings of 1 for the light and dark balance and 4 for the smoothness, just like we did in Photoshop. We're now at the same stage we were at in Photoshop, except there's one more feature of Illustrator we can make use of. Go to Object and Expand Appearance to apply these effects, then open up the Image Trace panel from the Window menu. Turn off the Snap Curves to Lines option and then turn on Ignore White. Reduce the Noise Slide to 1, then set the Paths option to 100%, then go to Object and Expand. This cool stamp effect is now 100% vector based and can be scaled to any size. This technique benefits from the best of both Photoshop and Illustrator methods. It retains that vector goodness, but it also looks great too, unlike that first Illustrator masking technique that didn't quite look as good as what we could achieve in Photoshop. So I hope this bunch of tips helps you out. If you enjoyed the video or learned anything new, I'd really appreciate some help to spread the word. Either a like on YouTube or a share on Twitter or Facebook would be fantastic. If you want to stick around for more, be sure to hit that subscribe button. Otherwise, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.